Kingdom greetings to you, our WOW TV listeners, and a very warm welcome. We are in Alberton today in our Nation Builders. We are looking at the 2016 election series. My name is Sarah Magibi, and I have with me in studio Reverend Kenneth Mishwe of the ACDP, which is the African Christian Democratic Party. We will be engaging with him on the issues of the 2016 local government elections. And so I do say most welcome to you, Reverend.
Thank you very much for your visit, and thank you very much for affording me the time to say something about our manifesto.
Yes, thank you so much. So I must say that I'm personally really looking forward to the engagement and honored to be able to have this time to really hear the heart of the ACDP, to hear the preparations that you have as we're going towards the 3rd of August. Well, that is the official election date, the 3rd of August. And particularly also to hear more about the manifesto, which was launched on the 21st of May, and hear your heart with regards to that, because we are a kingdom people. So this is more of a church community, and I think the heart of WOW TV and the heart of Nation Builders is to get the church committee geared up to understanding the importance of elections, and also not to just vote out of emotions, but to vote being informed and fully understanding what it is that they're actually voting for. So with that being said, perhaps the first point of call is to introduce you to our listeners and find out that who is Reverend Mishwe, particularly in the context of the African Christian Democratic Party.
You know, we are Christians who should be reminded that we have a great responsibility on the earth. We should be reminded that the earth belongs to our Father. And for the fact that the earth belongs to our Father, He wants His children to be involved in what He's involved in. There are Christians, unfortunately, who have been misled and deceived into believing that Christians should not be involved in politics. But remember, Jesus used to say, "What I see my Father do, that I do myself." And as a member of the ACDP, founder member of the ACDP, I believe I should follow in the footsteps of my Father. Mm-hmm. If Jesus did everything He saw His Father do, I also must follow in His footsteps and do what our Father is doing. Mm. One of the scriptures that opened my eyes to the importance of Christian responsibility, particularly answering those who say Christians should not involve in politics, is Isaiah 33:22. It says, "The Lord is our judge. The Lord is our lawgiver. The Lord is our king. He will save us." You know, Christians focus on the latter part of the Lord saving us, of being our Savior. They don't say much about Him being the judge. And I believe when the Lord allowed prophet Isaiah to give that truth to us, He was reminding us of the fact that our God is involved in the judicial systems of the world. He's a judge that has set a standard for us to be righteous judges. And He's a lawgiver. Lawmakers must be Christians because their Father is involved in lawmaking. And thirdly, He's the king. He is involved in rulership. He's involved in deciding the destinies of nations. So Christians should decide on what kind of rules should be in the land. Who should rule in the land? The king is a ruler. Christians should be rulers. As the Bible says, we are kings and priests unto God. So many of us, unfortunately, are kings that are unwilling to rule. But now, after I understood that, I decided I'm going to be a ruler. It should not be the unbelievers dictating the times, telling us what to do, what not to do, making laws for us. But it is us, as God's people, who should be dictating terms, because the earth does not belong to the devil, it belongs to our Father. And who can better know the heart of the Father? Who can better know how the earth should be run than His own children? Yeah. So with that understanding, I decided I'm going to be ruler because I'm following in the footsteps of my Heavenly Father. So we started the ACDP. And the ACDP obviously is a kingdom-minded political party. We want to follow the footsteps of our Father, and we want to rule as He rules. So the ACDP is based on biblical principles, and we believe that the scriptures address every area of life. The scriptures are not just about salvation from sin, healing from sickness, but the scriptures address every area of life. That is why when it comes to leadership in the ACDP and counselors who should represent us, we follow the advice that Moses was given by his father-in-law, Jethro, among others. Okay, Jethro said to Moses, choose leaders or select leaders who are capable, leaders who fear God, leaders who are trustworthy, leaders who hate dishonest gain. So in our manifesto, we refer to that scripture. We say to South Africa, we are offering you leadership and counselors who are capable and who fear God. Leaders, counselors, both men and women, who are faithful, and because they're faithful to God, they will automatically become faithful to the people they're serving and those who hate dishonest gain. Many times we hear Christians complaining about corruption. I think we should take the blame for corruption. Why? Because we are selecting people who don't fear God. We are selecting people who like dishonest gain. Whose fault is it, if not ours? Because the scriptures advise us that when we choose, I mean, even on the 3rd of August, when we'll be electing counselors, Christians should be reminded that God is expecting you to select men and women who are capable, and men and women who fear God, men and women who are faithful, and men and women who hate dishonest gain. How can we deal with this vast corruption? If we do not want to see the repeat of the corruption that we have been reading about, we want to turn to a new page these coming local elections, then let's go for counselors, men and women who fear God, men and women who are faithful, men and women who hate dishonest gain. Because if they do not hate dishonest gain, they are going to continue stealing from the public purse. They are going to continue stealing what should be used to service our poor people in the country.
Reverend, in your introduction, you made a statement that ACDP is a party that is formed on biblical principles.
Correct.
How do you answer people that make a statement that on the basis, I guess even the name itself, because we've heard people making such arguments that, okay, but ACDP is an African Christian Democratic Party, so it focuses only on the Christian. And then how would you answer that question to somebody who in their minds probably think that ACDP will only be for the Christian and does not particularly involve the constituency of South African people?
Such people do not understand that God is not God of the Christians. He's God of all creation. He's God of everybody. So anybody who understands scriptures, anybody who understands God, will not want to serve Christians only. Because God is not serving and taking care of Christians only. He is the God of all creation. So while we are African Christian Democratic Party, our focus is on everybody that God loves. We want people to understand our identity. We are not ashamed of the word Christ or Christian. That is who we are. That is our identity. But our calling is to serve everybody, regardless of whether they are religious or not religious. A heathen and a Christian, when it comes to service, are going to be serviced equally.
We are in a state where, you know, obviously being a democracy now, and there's always an argument about pushing humanism and people feeling that, you know, everybody can be themselves in whatever state that they're feeling. And also people may be misconceived perhaps in their thinking that Christianity or religion, as they've termed it, has no place in this era. What would you say, maybe the question for me that I want to point out is ACDP relevant to today in the midst of all these voices that are coming out that are making people more confused about their stance? Would you say ACDP is relevant today, and if so, why?
Well, ACDP is definitely relevant. Many of the people who say keep God out of politics, some will say keep religion out of politics, I remind them that humanism is a religion itself. I remind them that there is no African on this continent who is not religious. It's either they believe in God, who's alive, or Jesus Christ, or they believe in the dead. We know most Christians in this country that are not born again, and most people in South Africa believe in ancestral worship. Ancestral worship is a religion. So I think Christians allow the unbelievers to deceive them when they say to them, keep politics or religion out of politics, when they bring ancestral worship into politics. Okay? They speak as they understand what their ancestors are saying. And we speak as we understand what our Heavenly Father is saying. So there is nobody who can convince me that they are not religious while they are serving ancestors, while they are having these parties where the dead are honored, while they are visiting the graves and all that. We choose not to visit the grave because we don't want to serve the dead, but we want to serve the resurrected living Jesus Christ.
Yeah. Would you say that there is definitely perhaps a need to teach the church community at large in perhaps understanding the identity again of biblical basis or biblical values? Because as you've made the statement, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, you know, that within the Christian you have different types of Christians perhaps, and various people looking at the Christianities in variable ways. Now we are at the stage where, even as you said, that politics is one of those domains that also must be restored back to the rightful domain of the kingdom of God. Do you perhaps see that there is a need for such teaching? And if yes, whose responsibility is it at this time to make sure that the community gets taught so that when we talk Christian, for example, we understand that we are talking one language? I don't know if I'm making sense.
No, I agree with you that there is a definite need for kingdom teaching in our churches. Many of our people have not been taught. Obviously, basically, we have to start with teaching people about the importance of their relationship with God, the importance of repentance. We need to do that. Now, when Jesus spoke about repentance, he associated with the kingdom of God. Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. The kingdom of God is at hand. So we have to teach our people about kingdom lifestyle. We have to teach our people about kingdom living. And where do we start? That's a difficult question. Mm-hmm. If we could be everywhere, I mean, World Television has an excellent opportunity, because it's not only it's not only the evangelicals that watch the TV, but it's everybody else. Mm-hmm. So there needs to be opportunities and moments where we teach about the need for salvation. Mm-hmm. And from there, then we start teaching them about everything that has to do with the kingdom of God. Okay, the kingdom of God has to influence the kingdoms of this world. Mm-hmm. And this is what we have to teach. So if pastors can be brought together, because you are not a threat to anybody, because you are interdenominational, we are non-aligned, you know, in that sense. So you organize seminars and teach pastors and say to them, pastors, if you don't do the right thing, this country is going to sink. We need to teach our pastors about the importance of giving the message about the Lordship of Christ. A number of people believe Jesus is Lord, but he's Lord of their personal lives. It's Lord of their families, it's Lord of their churches. But people need to be taken a step further. Mm. Jesus is not only Lord of individuals or families, but is Lord of all. Mm. So the Lordship of Jesus Christ must be taught over every area of life. Mm. He is the Creator, and as the Creator, he has the right to be over his own creation. Mm. This must be taught, because if you don't teach it, unfortunately people are going to miss it.
I want us now to go into the manifesto. I know that you launched on the 21st of May. So I'd like us to just tell our viewers your heart. I love the quotation that kind of summarizes the manifesto. And of course, I mean, I'm just going to quote it, but I know you have, because it comes from your heart and the heart of your political party. But where you say the ACDP stands for freedom of religion, a free market economy with a social conscience, family values, community empowerment, and human rights in a federal system. Rev, can you just unpack the manifesto as it was launched on the 21st May and unpack it to our viewers so that they can understand what you're really about and what it is that you are promising the nation of South Africa in this local government elections?
Maybe let me start with the paragraph you just read from, that we believe in freedom of religion. Now, the reason we start with that is to allay the fears of people who think, and we have heard some people say, ACDP is going to force everybody to be a Christian, you know? And in response to that, I say, if you look at the man Jesus Christ, he never imposed himself on anybody. He never forced anybody to believe what he believed. He spoke the truth, and he said, whosoever will may come. And I think that is a democratic statement. It's giving people the democratic right to choose. That's why you say, whosoever will. It gives a choice, whosoever. So we are talking about freedom of religion so that people should not be intimidated, they should not be threatened, because we understand the message of the gospel, we understand what Jesus Christ said. That's very important. And the issue of the economy, obviously there is a debate today. There are some Christians who believe in socialism, and many of them base that on the early church book of Acts, that they had all things in common. And many of those who throw that at me, that the early church had everything in common, I said to them, when they brought their assets, when they brought their goods and all this stuff, they laid them at the feet of the apostles. But today you hear many communists and socialists say, we believe in socialism, but they don't want to bring that to the feet of the apostles. They want to have it themselves, and they do not share with the people who do not have. Now, when assets and goods are sold in order to take care for the poor, and they are brought to at the feet of the apostles, the apostles obviously are people who are expected to be just. And if they believe in justice, they distribute fairly to everybody that has a need. So the issue of people saying, why are you believing in capitalism? Because when you talk about the free market economy, it's capitalism, you know. Why do you believe in capitalism when the capitalists are robbing people and denying people what is expected of them? We are saying, we believe that you cannot have what you don't have.
Okay.
You cannot share what you don't have. So people must first have. We talk about the social conscience. When you have, don't close your heart to the needs of others. The Bible teaches us that if you see your neighbor naked, clothe them. See them hungry, feed them, okay? You cannot feed them if you don't have anything. So we are teaching, and we believe in the ACDP, that people must have the right to work with their hands to make a profit. Let me start from the paragraph you read. We started in that paragraph by saying we believe in freedom of religion, so that we can allay the fears of people who think that the ACDP will try and make everybody a Christian. And we say, no, that is not the case. When you look at scriptures, particularly the man Jesus Christ, he believed in individual rights. He never imposed his faith on anybody. He never imposed his beliefs on anybody, but he just spoke the truth and gave people the choice to decide. That is why he continually used the word whosoever. When he says whosoever, he says you have a choice. So because the ACDP believes in Christ, we will not force or impose our faith on anybody. Obviously, the wish is there that people should have the relationship with Christ. But at the same time, we respect the individual rights of people, and we follow Christ, who said, whosoever. If you want to accept it, okay, that's fine, you know. But then the other issue in that paragraph you read that a number of people ask questions about is the statement that we believe in a free market economy with a social conscience. Now, among those who are not excited by that are those who say they are socialists, they believe in socialism because they see socialism in the Bible, in the book of Acts, the early church, they had all things in common, and they say when you have a market economy, that does not happen, all right? I say, but we are talking about an economy that is people, that is driven by people with a social conscience. What do you mean by that? We mean if you see a need, you need to do something about it. But before you can do something about any need, you must have something to share. Okay? And so a free market economy gives you an opportunity to work with your hands. And God promised to bless the works of our hands. And then when you have something, then from the something you have that you worked for, then you need to share with others. You are not forced. You are not, we do not want to make a law that forces people to take from one and give to the other. That obviously would be wrong, because even God does not do that. Okay, Jesus never did that. He just said from our love and our care, we need to share with those that do not have. So the ACDU believes that when we encourage people to start their own businesses, people to be successful, when they are successful, they must not forget that God has blessed them to be a blessing to other people. That's why He blesses us. He blesses us to be a blessing to other people. So with this free market economy, you have your own budget, you have your own business, you have your own successes and all this stuff. But because we are emphasizing a social conscience, help those that don't have. Do not be selfish, but help those that you don't have.
On this point of the free market economy, and I know maybe you're still going to continue to elaborate on some of the key factors about the manifesto. But, you know, as a country being in a place where, well, I mean, it's not South Africa only, but we know economically the pressures that we are under right now. I mean, when you look at the challenges South Africa is facing, all the ratings and, you know, all these things that are coming up and bring fear almost. I mean, we look at the rand comparatively to the euro, comparatively to the dollar, and now with this move of Britain coming out of Europe, and everybody's afraid basically, then high prices, then there's the drought. All of these things are bringing pressure economically. What is the message of hope that you are giving to South Africans in the midst of all these challenges that we are having economically?
Many things go wrong because we don't do things God's way. South Africa, I believe, will come to a time where we are the lighthouse of the world. I'm looking forward to the time when South African leaders and other African leaders will go to Europe not with begging bowls, but with checkbooks and check cards. Go to leaders out there and say to them, how can we help you? Rather than, how can you help me? You know, and the turnaround will come when there is righteousness in leadership. It's important that there should be righteousness in leadership. And besides this righteousness in leadership, if I go back to scriptures, I remember what God said to Abraham, I will bless those who bless you. And He also said, all nations of the earth will be blessed through you. Even though this is not in the manifesto, it's something that blesses me, encourages me, and I hope that as we share this with the viewers, they are going to look forward to this time of putting the ACDP in a place to make it happen. Do you know, until the 60s, late 60s, the rand was stronger than the US dollar. There was a time when you needed $3 to buy one rand. Can you imagine South Africa coming to that stage where $3 equals to one rand? Today is $1 compared to almost 16 rands because we have missed it somewhere. Let me not give all the details, but just to say, I'm making people curious so that they can want to have that day again when the South African rand is stronger than the US dollar. And for that to happen, ACDP has the strategy. ACDP knows it can be done. Other political parties cannot say this because they don't know how to do it. We know how to do it. In the late 60s, many countries on the African continent, you ask the Zimbabweans, you ask people from the DRC, you ask people from Malawi, you ask all of them who tell you our currencies were stronger than the US dollar. Now the question is, what went wrong? The ACDP knows what went wrong. You become curious, elect and choose the righteous as God is advising us. And I promise you, and now this is one of the promises I will make. that if we do things God's way, we're going to succeed. This period when African countries had currencies that were stronger than US dollar, it has to do with the blessing of Abraham. That there's no time to talk about it now. But I can tell you, if South Africans who are tired of this unemployment can say, let's try the ACDP, ACDP will say, we are going to work with God and not against God. Other political parties, they push God aside as if they are all-knowing and they are failing. The ACDP says, we want to work with God to ensure that South Africa becomes a model among nations of the world. Now, I'm thinking, something comes to mind now. In the 1996, we had a team from the church visit a city called Aziz in Brazil. Three things happened when we were in that city that I will never forget the rest of my life, and that I'm praying that would happen in South Africa, my own country. Firstly, between our residence when we were there and the meeting place, the church where we met, we drove past a city park. And Brazilians many times have very long meetings. We'd finish 12, midnight, 1 a.m. and so on. And whenever we drove back home, we would pass, we would see women and children in the city park playing. And you know, coming from Josie, we all had one question. Women in the park, 12 midnight, won't they be raped? That was a question we asked. And the answer was, not here. Women are not raped in Aziz. In other cities like Rio, they are, but not here, because we know how to deal with rapists. I looked at that and said, Lord, I pray that before I die, I will live in a South Africa where women can walk in the streets 12 midnight without fearing somebody will rape them. I saw it is possible to live in such a city. The second thing that we saw there, our residence was opposite a tavern. One Saturday morning, a gentleman came with what I call a push me before I go car. No self-starter. He came, parked this car in front of our residence, walked across the road into the tavern. The car was idling in front of us. We come from Johannesburg, where cars are stolen even when you have a gorilla on the steering wheel, okay? We looked at that car, it's idling, the key is in the ignition. I looked at my watch. The gentleman was in the tavern for about 20 minutes, drinking. We asked our host, is this not dangerous? Won't this car be stolen? The answer, cars are not stolen in Assis. Other places, yes, but here we know how to deal with criminals. You know how to deal with criminals. We're going to apply the same thing in South Africa when South Africans, particularly Christians, give us an opportunity. My cars have been stolen. And I know a number of viewers have cars that have been stolen. Many of them wish I can leave my car without fearing that somebody will steal it. Mm-hmm. If that is the case, the ACDP knows how to ensure that cars are not stolen. Okay? The third thing that I'll never forget. The mayor of the city hosted us for dinner one evening. For lunch. During the lunch meeting, after he spoke, he said we could ask questions. My question to him was, Your Honor, since we came here, we have not seen any beggar in the street. Don't you have poor people? We asked him. And he said, no, we have plenty of poor people. So he said, why don't we see them in the streets? I mean, all the traffic lights, nobody, there's nobody there. Where are they if you are poor people? He said, no. He said, so they have a center where they take poor people, destitute people, and they keep them for maximum 14 days. And he said, during those 14 days, they trace the relatives and the families of those people they found in the streets. Because they operate from the premise that there is no poor person without a family. And they've concluded that if a person leaves the house, there must be a problem in home, in the home. So during that 14 days, when they find the family member, they bring that family member together with that person they found in the street. And if there is a problem, they bring reconciliation. They involve social workers and psychologists to ensure that there is a relationship that will ensure that they live together. And then if the person is not employed, there is no food, they say they help that family with the necessary food, they help that person until that person also find a job. They also help that person to find a job. Now, I looked at this and said, South Africa, how many poor people are in the streets? And many of these people have families. A number of times, particularly during Christmas, you hear, and I've read, and somewhere I must be having articles about this. I've read of police in Hillbro, for example, taking children back home to spend Christmas with their parents. After Christmas, what do? Back in the streets. Because government does not have a vision. Let's address the root cause why this child prefers to be in the streets when they have the family. We, because we are promoting family values, who do not want to see anybody in the streets, do not want to see husbands living like hobos when they have their own houses, but we believe that we can use the services of psychologists and social workers to bring about families that are broken down and families that are fought, resulting in one of them living in the streets. So these three things, these are things that we say to South Africa. We will remove people in the streets, these hobos in the streets. We'll make them, we'll help restore their dignity by making sure that they don't live under the trees, they don't live in the open, but live in the homes. It can be done. We have seen it in Aziz in Brazil.
I'm going to attempt to ask you maybe a bit of a controversial question. You know, as you're talking, maybe I'm taking you back a little bit again to the economic portion. You spoke about what God brings as a blessing of Abraham. You spoke about how God blesses the work of our hands, which then you also talked about then people in South Africa in this context having opportunities to build their own businesses. But now we know currently the stance of the current government has been a strong focus on making promises to say government had now the responsibility to create jobs. What is the stance of ACDP with regards to, is it a job creation issue, or is it focusing moving from government having the responsibility to create job or teaching people to then build their own businesses? I don't know if I'm making sense in my question.
It is not the responsibility of government to create jobs. Government must create the climate conducive for investments and job creation. And one of the key things government should do is to ensure that there is order, there is security, there is safety for the potential investors. Because if you have a climate where strikes take place all the time, there is violence all the time, then potential investors become reluctant because they do not have the assurance that their assets will be safe. Mm-hmm. So the ACDP says, let's create a climate that is conducive. South Africa today, unfortunately, if I was an investor, I would not want to invest if I was not assured that there would hooligans will come and burn my business or break into my business, as you saw happening in Mamelodi. I mean, investors who see that, they would not want to invest in the country. So our image has been badly dented because government has failed to make the climate conducive for job creation. So the ACDP would say, when we are in authority, we'll ensure that there is safety and security. We will teach people that you don't have the right to somebody's property, somebody's assets. We don't have the right to take what does not belong to you. These are the ABCs that should be taught to people. And when the climate is conducive, there is peace, there is respect. Even the local investors, because we do not just want to depend on foreign investors. Mm-hmm. Local people can invest in their own economy. And many are not investing in their own economy because of the uncertainty. Mm-hmm. How safe are my assets going to be? Mm-hmm. So it's important that people understand it is not government's responsibility to create jobs. Mm-hmm. Business, particularly small business, mm-hmm. is something that is very close to our hearts. The interesting thing is to know that the National Development Plan mm-hmm. says by 2030, 90% of small businesses should be, let me rephrase that, 90% of our economy should be depending on small business. That is the goal. But at the rate we are going, it's not going to happen. For us to have this 90% of the economy coming from small businesses, we must have another government, because the current one does not have a vision for it. There's something that is close to my heart that is happening that needs attention, that our government is not giving it necessary attention. Spaza shops. Local businesses in the townships are struggling. Many of them have been taken over. Obviously, one has to be careful when you talk about this, because you do not want to be sound like you are not in favor of people from outside coming. No, no, that's not the issue. The issue is when you have a local unsubsidized business person competing against somebody who just came in but to subsidize, the playing field is not level. So the ACDP believes the playing field must be leveled. If those coming from wherever are subsidized, and there are a lot of such claims and rumors, but government's not investigating them. They should be investigated. And the reason is because we want to level the playing field so that our people should not just lose their businesses, should not just lose their spaza shops. Now, those that have lost them, many of them are crying. They want them back. But they cannot compete against these prices because people, some people are subsidized. Now, to prove about this subsidization that I'm talking about, a person comes in your area, no relatives. Within 3 months, he has a business. And in this business, his goods are cheaper than Pick and Pay, Checkers, and these major chain stores. You ask yourself a question, how is it possible? How long did it take Pick and Pay or Checkers or Spa to come where they are? And yet, somebody has come from nowhere and is cheaper than them. Somebody must be subsidizing them. People have to start thinking, how is this possible? Okay. And now you also look at how they conduct themselves in their businesses. You realize that they are breaking all health regulations. Government is not doing anything about it. So the ACDP says, we want health inspectors to be brought back so that they will ensure that nobody sleeps in the spaza shops they are selling from. As you should know, townships, what's happening at the townships? People sleep in them, people wash in them, some say even toilet in them, no health regulations. And many will tell you, we never saw them taking a mattress or a bed in the shop. So where do they sleep? They take bags of millimil, sleep on it, and then sell it to our people. Now, this is not right. And these are some of the issues that the ACDP is addressing. That the ACDP is saying, we want our people to be given healthy food. We want inspectors to ensure that many of our people who are sick is not because of the food they are eating, some of it that has beyond expiry date. Some of it, we are told, they erase the expiry date and put another date. Some of them, people are buying rotten chicken. Actually, the last confrontation and violence we had in this area was because of a young man who was sold rotten chicken. Bought the chicken, went home, and he discovered that the chicken is rotten. Takes it back to the store, the person refuses, and takes it back to the store, says, give my money back, and they refuse. Now, ACP wants to make sure that things like this do not happen. Many of our people become angry because they see government is not doing anything about it. These things I'm telling you were in the newspapers. Government knows about them, but government is doing nothing. So ACDP says, we believe our people must have small businesses. And when they have small businesses, the ACDP says, we will teach them with skills. We'll help them with skills. We'll help them with skills because many of our people cannot compete because they're not skilled enough. So ACDP says, skills development must be part of small businesses if we want them to succeed. And then secondly, we want to put a mentor next to this person who's just starting their business to make sure that they succeed. There are many people out there who are successful, whose gifts and talents are not utilized. We want to take the skills and the talents of the successful business people and say to them, can you help? And I can tell you, we have many good South Africans with a good heart who want to help. You are a successful businessman. I say to you, yes, the lady who's starting this business because of your success, would you mind help working with her, helping her? And I promise you, the majority of them would say, yes, we'll do that. But it's not happening in South Africa. Why? Because we have a government that does not have a vision. So we want to see small businesses grow. Small businesses have visions to also one day have their own malls. Okay, we want them to have that. But for them to get there, they must be skilled, they must be trained, and they must have a mentor that the ACDP wants to walk with them the road so that they will be able ultimately to do that.
Sure. I want us to move along, Reverend, to the issue of education. And I mean, I would have loved for us to go in detail over every aspect and health and transport and all of that. But because time is not our friend right now, but I'm going to focus maybe on the key things that I know that generally are at the heart of South Africans, particularly where there's huge challenges about this. So I just wanted you to maybe speak briefly on the issue of education, what the stand of ACDP is on the issue of education. I mean, we know currently some of the challenges we are having there. And when I'm talking education, I'm talking education very broadly, right from the young child up to the highest level, and also even whether we are talking formal or informal education. So if you could just elaborate a bit on
that. Okay, firstly, the ACDP believes that education is the responsibility of the parents.
Amen to that. Sorry, that's just me, my part.
It is the responsibility of the parents. We do not believe that government must become a big nanny and be a parent to everybody. And obviously some governments want that to do so that people should think that my government is my provider. I need a job, they give me a job. I want education, they give me education. I want whatever I want, I can look to government. No, we do not want that to happen. But the ACDP encourages parents to have a say in the education of their children in the school. Okay, they teach children first at home, and from there, when curriculum is drafted, we look at success stories, successful countries, and we also look at the word. What does the word say about education? We marry what we get from the word and with a successful countries. Countries that are producing the best. Countries that are producing children who love mathematics and science. We look for them. And then we see how we can work together. Now with ACDP, we are not ashamed to ask for help when we need help. Other parties, they want to be seen as, I can do it all. We know there's one that knows everything. We don't know everything. Where we lack, we ask those who are successful to help us. We believe in working with the successful. If you know the scripture say, if you walk with the wise, you'll be wise. Okay? So if you want to be successful, walk with the successful. If I may make an example about countries that are known, Cuba, for example. What has Cuba produced that has helped the world? Don't know anything, myself, I don't know anything. And yet the government say, we choose to work with Cuba. We choose to send our students there. Then I can say, let's look at Israel, for example. When you look at the statistics, Israel has produced the more people that have won Nobel Peace Prizes. More than any others. The people are successful. You look at their contribution in medicine. You look at the contribution in agriculture. Because Israel, we are not interested. They have produced technology that has helped the world. And yet we are not going to them. We go to comrades who have not blessed the world with anything. So now the ACDP says, you want the best education, look at who is successful. You may not agree with everything they do, but for the sake of our children, we want them to get the best education. So we learn from those and we partner with those who are successful. We want to have children who know more about mathematics than our generation. Children today who know more about sex than they do about mathematics. If there can be a competition among young people, sex, who knows better, South Africa will be number one. Competition, mathematics, South Africa, number last. The ECDP wants it to be the other way around. Okay? We want our children to be taught the best. And we also believe children must be taught values. Children must be taught values. We have children today who have no values at all. Children who do not know what is an adult, who do not care about the teachers, who want to say what they want to say, whenever they want to say, they don't care. We want to bring up children that are responsible. And to help with that also, obviously, we want to bring discipline in the schools. I believe discipline is part or should be part of education that will mold an individual or a child to become a responsible parent. As Christians, obviously, we would want the influence of scriptures to also come upon our children, because our children must know what God expects them to do and what God does not expect them to do. We would want to teach that. Even in public schools, we are not going to force religion on anybody, but principles. There are principles in scripture that can be applied in education without quoting chapter and verse. The principles that make a person to be a responsible individual. I'm not sure whether I said enough.
You said it. You made a statement, and I know that we will probably come to a draw, close and take a break and then continue. But you made a statement during the manifesto, and I didn't think I would say it, but I think it raises it in what you've just spoken about, particularly in the context of education, particularly also in the context of small businesses. And talking about peace and reconciliation, you said South Africa does not need more fighters, but builders. Remember that. I would like you to elaborate on that. You made a statement that I personally like and I agree on. Not that my opinion is important in this discussion right now, but when you talk about that, it is the responsibility of the parents to start with education at home. Reverend, we have a crisis in our nation, and part of that crisis is not just in government, but you have citizens that refuse to be accountable for their own actions. We have citizens that refuse to believe that they have a role to some extent in assisting the nation to be built going forward. So in light of that quotation that it just captured my heart when I raised it, obviously, when it was put out in the news. Can you just elaborate on that? Because we really do believe that we are in an era of nation builders, and that it will take much more than just government itself to build this nation. And so when you made that statement to say South Africa does not need more fighters but builders, what was in the heart of ACDP with that particular statement? As part of educating even the viewers who are sitting at home, for some of them it might be the first time really coming to terms in what I call sacrificing the sacred cows of their religion, where they thought, as long as I'm a Christian in my private space. But now, as you are talking about the values and some of the challenging things that you've raised, what would you say, just unpack that statement. What does it mean, and what is in the heart of moving from freedom fighters to now builders that are needed to take the country forward?
We know that fighting involves, among other things, loss of life. Fighting divides people. Fighting causes children to rise against parents and parents against children, neighbors against one another. Fighting does not bring together. Fighting scatters people. Some of the people who are in the streets are because there was fighting at home. Endless fighting in the house. So a person says, for peace sake, let me go and live with the birds outside. Looking at what Christ was teaching, Christ was a man of peace. That's why he said, when he taught his people, blessed are the peacemakers. Jesus Christ was a man of peace that we should emulate. Then the Apostle Paul said, the Lord has given us a ministry of reconciliation. It is a fact that we have a very sad, bad, and evil past, where people were divided all the time. Now that we are in a new democracy, where people have choices, we should use our choices constructively. We should use our choices to reach out to one another. People of all races, we should make the choice to live together. We should make the choice of building South Africa together. Because there is a devil in the world, he has his agenda. He wants people to remain divided. That's why he will use people to say things that are not to be said, to say things that they know. This is not going to build. This is not going to bring people together. This is not going to bring the nation together. This is going to divide the nation. So people, there are people who just want trouble. So South Africans must be aware of that, particularly Christians, that they must be aware that there are people who just want trouble because they are influenced by other forces. But while they see that, they must make a choice. The choice I make is, I'm not going to cause trouble. I'm going to be a bridge builder. I'm going to be a nation builder. I will use my tongue and my mouth constructively, rather than tear people down, say things that are hurtful. It is a choice I make to be constructive, to be encouraging, to help those who think they have no future, to look up, lift up their heads, and be confident that even though I have failed, even though I have fallen, I remember the scripture that says, though a righteous man falls 7 times, he rises again. I look for opportunities to see those who say, I can't make it, and say to them, remember the Apostle Paul said, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. It is possible for you to succeed. It is possible to you to break the ceiling and to be the first in your own house. It is a decision that every one of us South Africans have to make, particularly Christians, to use our mouths and our tongues to help others, to build others, and not to destroy others. The language of fighting all the time, fighting, 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 is being spoken by some politicians. That is why the level of destruction of poverty in South Africa is increasing. And Christians need to confront this by start talking positively, by start telling these people who are fighting, fighting, talking about fighting all the time, this is not the time to fight. This is the time to build the nation. The unfortunate thing with politicians that are calling people to fight is that they are always in the background. They have bodyguards. They live in houses with big walls, sophisticated alarms. They are safe. When they speak that language, they are sending the ignorant, uninformed young people to go to the front. And it is these young people who lose their lives because they are not guarded and protected as these politicians are. So I pray that Christians, in particular in South Africa, should not be supporters of people who just want to fight. Even to say, I want to fight you in order to get what you have. I rather say, I want to learn how you got what you have so that I can do what you can do and so that I can have what you have. Unfortunately, this is not the language that the politicians speak. But the ACDP is saying, that's why we speak about mentoring. Let those who are successful stand alongside of those who try, those who want to come to the level where the successful people are. Once we understand that there are people out there who want to help, and we understand that it is not government that is a nation builders, but it is us citizens, and we are willing to take our role, South Africa has the opportunity and has the potential to be the best among the best in the world. And I'm praying that Christians will be known as nation builders. And to be a nation builder, obviously, it starts at home. In the house, in the home, be a builder. How you talk to one another in the house, let there be respect. Let there be a choice to, I'm going to work with my family. I'm working with my family. My family are contributing in nation building. But it started with me. When I said, it is the choice I make. I have a wife, I have children that I must influence to make such choices so that we are contributors in society. We are not destroyers, but we are contributors. So I pray that many Christians out there would want to be nation builders. Those, obviously, who say it has nothing to do with me, that you don't understand scriptures. The Lord wants us to be ministers of reconciliation. When people fight, we don't throw the petrol, don't throw fuel, don't throw. When people fight, remember the Lord said, we are nation builders and we are peacemakers. So let us truly be peacemakers and nation builders so that this beautiful country of ours can be a model among nations of the world.
Well, amen to that. Yeah. We are out of time, Reverend. We are going to take a short break and we are going to continue. But I just really want to say to the to our viewers that it is our responsibility as WOW TV to inform you, which is part of the heart of why we are tackling the session on 2016 elections. But it is also your responsibility to respond to that information and choose wisely and vote wisely and engage your mind, engage your heart, so that when you go to the polls on the 3rd of August, it's not just an emotional extension, but you have truly, truly engaged every part of your God-given skill that has been given to you to make sure that when you put a cross, you are being part of a nation builder for this country, South Africa. We'll be back with you shortly. Thank you.